السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. This is Yasir Qadhi on behalf of Muslim Matters. For further interesting Islamic podcasts, please log on to our website www.muslimmatters.org. جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، ثم أما بعد. And they say that Islam doesn't really care about sport or fitness. In a culture like ours nowadays, which is known as a body culture, you'll find that most men and women care about the way they look. For men, it's to be masculine, which means full of muscles. For women, it's beauty. And they all do whatever they can to do in order to arrive at that level of beauty. So most of them, of course, they go on diets. Some of them, they try all kinds of exercises, buy all kinds of expensive or inexpensive machines. They try everything just to be in shape, so that when they go out, people, they look at them and they say, wow. Why? Because it's a body culture. Does Islam promote something like this? Is it part of our faith and religion that we look nice? And for men to, mashallah, have muscles, and for women to look nice and beautiful? What is exactly the statement or the call of Islam when it comes to sport and fitness? If we see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, try to visualize Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the eyes of his own followers, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be amazed. You see, the Sahaba, they were very meticulous, and they were watching the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for every single step and every single even movement to describe this for us, because they knew how important for people who will come after them to hear about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his message. Therefore, they gave us full description and detailed description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam physically, spiritually, as a messenger, as a prophet, as a man, as a husband, and so forth. And look at the description of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the physical description of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to the extent that they counted the gray hairs on his head sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were only 3 before he died sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mashallah, they say kana azim al-qadr, which means he had that full size. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had wide shoulders. If you ask men, what do you like to see about your shoulders? They would like to have very wide shoulders. So when they walk, their arms go a little bit to the side, showing that they have muscles. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had that naturally. Kana sallallahu alaihi wasallam dakhma al-idham والذراعين. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has full arms, and that's what men usually love to see and like. If you ask those who go to the gym, they care about different muscles, of course, but few of them really care about those muscles of the arms. So they would have, mashallah, fine arms and shoulders and so on, but when it comes to their hands, kind of weak. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was full. His legs, they described his thighs, his feet, his shoulders, his chest, his back, they describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the description of Rasulullah shows you a man who was, mashallah, was really fit. And we will know the reason, inshallah ta'ala, in this lecture. Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the way he walks. He said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَسْرَعَ مِنَ النَّبِيِّ sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I have never seen someone who walks faster than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not a walk of arrogance, no. It's naturally because he's fit. He was athletic, so when he walks naturally, and he walks fast. He said, كَأَنَّمَا الْأَرْضُ تُطْوَى لَهُ. As if the land, means the earth, was folded up for him. So he goes distances faster than anybody else. He said, إِنَّا نَنَجْهَدُ أَنفُسَنَا وَهُوَ غَيْرُ مُكْتَرِدُ. That we do our best to catch up with him, but we could not. Means the Prophet ﷺ would be actually going faster than what they do. Does Islam care about fitness, about sport? Nowadays, again, the culture educates us that, you know, the less work you do, the more time you save. That's the concept. And therefore, they invented what is well known for us nowadays as drive-through, you know, windows, everything, for everything. Everything has a drive-through window. So, if you are going to buy food, You don't have to stretch your feet out of your car. No, just wait there. They're going to bring it to you, inshallah ta'ala. And if you are going to buy medicine because you're sick, then you also can get it drive-through. I mean, you need to walk, to move around so that you can become fit. But they still want you to go drive-through windows. Even nowadays, which is actually probably off the topic, even marriages can be done drive-through. You'll find people coming to Islamic centers just 5 minutes before Salat al-Isha or Maghrib, coming to the Imam saying, Shaykh, you know, we want to get married. Can you help us do that quickly? Without giving any background check or see if they have everything prepared or whatever. Just let us do it and we'll find, we'll help you with that. Many people who go to those gyms, they don't have the probably the good intention or the correct intention for working out. So if you ask so many young people, men or women, most of them, they would actually go there for showing off or socializing. So they go there to show off that, mashallah, they're always carrying those bottles with them, Gatorade bottles or drinks or kind of special sport wears, all this stuff. Why? Because they're coming from the gym. Other people, they go there just to show off so they can socialize and probably engage or find their future spouse and all the stuff and so on. But to go there for the right intention, the good intention, few of them will do that. The serious people usually, and if you go to a gym actually, you would realize how people classify those who come to the gym, depending on the time that they use it. Those who come early before Fajr time, which is basically when it first opens, the serious people. Most of them are doctors, engineers probably, lawyers, those kind of people. Then who come after that, a little bit, you know, those who are just average people. And then after that, you will find most of them housewives, moms, and so on, after they send the kids to school. And then after that, after lunchtime, you know, you'll find some students, some part-time job people, and so on. So they know when do they go to the gym. So most of people, they go for convenience, and they go, of course, for different purposes. As a Muslim, you have a different perspective for sport and fitness. We all know that sound mind can be found in a sound body. If you don't have a sound body, you cannot have that sound mind. And you have to be fit in order to know how to function properly, mentally speaking. We also understand and realize, if you are, mashallah, physically fit, it's going to be easier for you to wake up for Fajr, to wake up for Qiyam al-Layl, and to fast, optional fasting, and to do so many activities that require physical, probably, you know, effort from you. This body for a Muslim is an amanah, it's a trust. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this body, not as a portrait to use it for, you know, for tattoos and pictures and stuff like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this as an amanah and trust. And He will question you about this body. What did you do to yourself? In our society, when you have, as I said, you know, so many drive-through activities and programs and things and so on, people, they suffer a lot of diseases and sicknesses. If you go to the hospitals, you will see that. Senior citizens, they become weaker. Why? Because at an early age, they did not exercise, did not practice anything. Because of the lifestyle of nowadays. If you go to a small town, if you go to Europe, which I lived for 4 years over there, you will find a different lifestyle. People there, they drive less and they walk actually more. They carry stuff with their hands instead of, you know, putting them in the trunk. They do a lot of natural activities in order to keep naturally fit. In this society, our lifestyle is kind of different. It's all about saving time. And saving time comes, unfortunately, on the account of wasting our body. So even if it's just to go out to Walgreens or probably across the street to buy something from the grocery store or maybe even from a gas station, people, they drive. They don't even go across the street. So they go and they drive because it became like a culture. Last night we spoke about da'wah. And we said that Ad-da'wah is the profession of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the messengers of Allah azza wa jal. And then, since we don't have any prophets, any messengers anymore, it becomes our job as the followers of the prophet to carry their message and to continue that. But to become a successful da'ya, you have to be active, physically active, mentally active, spiritually active, all kinds of aspects of your life, you have to be active in that. So the da'wah, it becomes like khilafah. It means you're actually like being the deputy on this on earth for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to carry the message of the anbiya. Now, if you are not physically fit, you're going to always be lazy. If we ask you to come to attend for a conference, well, I'm too tired to do that. If you would like to, for example, participate in a drive or something like that, you're still, again, lazy to do so. Or maybe because it's better for you to go and take a nap or go and get some sleep because you have been studying and sitting in front of the computer all day. So sitting in front of the computer became the exercise of so many people because they're exercising their fingers, nothing more. How did Islam care about fitness? Do we really have anything about fitness or sport in Islam? I mean, read the Quran. Wow, even in the Quran. Yes, even in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the story of the children of Israel, Banu Israel, after the time of Musa alayhi salam. When they asked Allah azza wa jal to bring them a king whom they're going to follow, to bring them victory and send them back again to their homeland from where they have been kicked out. And they said, "Oh Allah, bring us a king, a man that we're going to follow, inshaAllah ta'ala, to bring our homeland back from the enemy." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for them a king, Talut Malika. So Allah sent them Talut as a malik, a king. They were surprised. What was their analogy? They looked at him, they didn't recognize him very well. They said, قَالُوا أَنَّ يَكُونَ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ عَلَيْنَا وَلُمْ يُؤْتَ سَعَةً مِّنَ الْمَالِ. How come he's going to be a king when he has no money? I mean, he's not rich. How is he going to do things? He cannot do these things if he doesn't have the money for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is, of course, this is laziness. You can buy everything off the internet if you have a credit card. You don't have to go and buy it outside. Same thing, that same mentality. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the answer to the Prophet. And he said, قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهُ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen him for you. اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chosen him for two reasons. Because of what he was given of knowledge and al-jism. Jism means body. But he is not necessarily the physical flesh. No. It's the aspect of the body. When you praise the body, you praise it for what? For being strong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the strength of Talut. He was strong. What is the significance of sport anyway and fitness? It's that thing, strength and power. So he was powerful. He was so strong. It means he would do things physically that would amaze other people. And when it comes to leadership, especially of that time, when the king, instead of walking from behind offices and desks, they would lead the armies. So they need a leader, a king, who is so strong, physically fit and physically strong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them that man. So that physical power is mentioned in the Quran. Another example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, about Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul. Do we know the five Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul? What is the meaning of Ulul Azm anyway? Al-Azm, the word Azm. Azm has different interpretations. It can be translated to resolve, intention, and also can be translated as strength and power. So the word of power, strength, physically strong, and also spiritually they were strong. Can you count them? Who were they? Number one. The first prophet? No. Before. Before Ibrahim, Nuh. Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. How do you recognize his physical power? He made an ark, a whole boat, by himself. He didn't have anybody with him. He was building it by himself. And the people were going, just passing by him, building that ark in the middle of the desert, and they were mocking him. So what do you think you're doing? Where the water is going to come from? And he was building it. That was Nuh alayhi salam. Next one, who was it? Ibrahim alayhi salam. What did he do? He built the Kaaba. Before that, when he was young, he destroyed all their gods by himself. He destroyed everything. He was so strong, powerful. Who's next?
Musa.
Musa alayhi salam. What did he do? Just knocked the person down. He just pushed him and the guy died. That was Musa alayhi salam. And there is another example about Musa alayhi salam. When he escaped Egypt, and on the way he was resting in the shade of a tree, and he saw the two daughters of that man, Shu'aib. Some they say he was the prophet Shu'aib, Allahu A'lam. But he saw those two young ladies grabbing their, you know, their sheep that they avoided to mix with the men. So he saw that and he just, you know, felt, you know, I'm gonna help them. So he stands up and he goes and he asks them, what's wrong with you? They say, we cannot take our sheep until they're done. So he goes and he takes their sheep for them, and then he actually, from amongst all those people, he pushes them, and he managed to finish first, and then he goes back to those ladies, says, here you go. Then that lady, she goes and she speaks to her father about him. And the father, you know, he wanted to see this man. So she goes to Musa alayhi salam, she calls him. She said, my father wants to see you, if you don't mind. So he comes and he walks in front of her, not behind her. So to avoid, of course, looking at her. So he was walking in front of her, out of shyness, of course, and she would guide him to go right, left, and so on, until they arrive at home. So there she talks to her father and she said, إن خير من استأجر قات يا أبت استأجره. Hire him to be your shepherd. Why don't you just hire him as a shepherd and let us relax? So إن خير من استأجرت القوي الأمين. The best that you will hire would be القوي الأمين. قوي means what? Strong. And Musa showed that physical strength and power. الأمين, trustworthy. How did she recognize his trustworthiness? Walking in front of her. I mean, if he was up to something, he would go behind her. But he was actually honest enough to go in front of her and not watching her. So she recognized that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanding this ummah also in the Quran saying, وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ قُوَّةٍ. Prepare for them, for the enemy. مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ قُوَّةٍ. Whatever you can, whatever you can afford, of what? Of قُوَّةٍ. And quwwah here again means power. Power can be that physical power or anything else. The ulama, as the Prophet ﷺ explained the meaning of quwwah over here, one of its aspects, he said, قال ألا إن القوة الرمي ألا إن القوة الرمي ألا إن القوة الرمي. Three times. Which means that if you want to find power and strength, you will find it in archery. In archery, in archery. Three times. Or basically it's throwing, whether it's actually archery or artillery or anything else that we find nowadays. The sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Sahaba were very excited and happy that they were going to make Umrah after a long separation from Mecca and fighting and struggling for their rights to go and make Tawaf and Umrah in Mecca, They managed to arrive at Mecca during Al-Hudaybiyah. That was the 6th Hijri year. There, they were banned from reaching Mecca. And they were very upset. Then the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah took place. They had to go back to Medina. The following year, they came back for Umrah. What did the people of Mecca say? They allowed them, of course, to go to Umrah. And they said, fine, just let them go in. And say, you're going to see people who are very weak. Why? Because the humma of Al-Madina means the fever of Medina. Medina was a place had a lot of probably humidity and moisture, so it's a place of basic diseases. So they say the diseases of Medina had made them exhausted. Means you'd find them in full fatigue, actually. Do you have connection with other room?
No,
it should be okay. Okay. So, and they say, just you're going to watch them and see, very weak people. It means they're not going to fight against you anymore. So the Prophet ﷺ, overhearing those statements, he said, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ امْرَأً أَرَاهَمَ الْيَوْمُ مِنْهُ قُوَّةٌ. May Allah have mercy on someone who will show power and strength. It means that the Prophet was encouraging people to show that strength, that physical power and strength. And he himself did that. What did he do? He established this tashri' and tawaf. How many of you have gone to Umrah or Hajj? Alhamdulillah. For the brothers, if you go and make your tawaf, the first tawaf, what do you do? You reveal your what? Your right shoulder. And you put the ihram from underneath. What for? Why not the left one? Anyway. Because the right one is stronger. Because most people, they're right-handed. So they use it a lot, and that's why the shoulder and their arms will be probably stronger than the left one. In general speaking. So when they go, the Prophet ﷺ said, show them your muscles, basically. So they go out, showing their muscles, and they start even the process of ar-ramal, which is jogging. The first 3 rounds around the Kaaba, when you make your tawaf, you should be actually basically jogging. So the people of Mecca were watching them, they were looking at those people, they say, Wallahi ma bihim min bas. There is nothing wrong with those guys. It means that what they assumed that they're going to be weak, they were surprised that they were not. Because the Prophet ﷺ said so. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he himself, before that even, long time before that, when he found that, you know, actually saw the rejection of the people of Mecca, he went out to seek shelter and help from somewhere else. And that was At-Ta'if. At-Ta'if. Does anybody know where At-Ta'if is? Where is it exactly?
6 miles
from
Mecca.
6 miles from Mecca, where?
Mountain.
Mountain of At-Ta'if.
It's a valley.
No. Actually, At-Ta'if is on the summit of the mountain. It's very, very high. I've been there twice. And you drive for about 45 minutes to arrive there, because it's actually a zigzag road. You keep going all the way up. All the way up. 45 minutes driving. Do you know that the Prophet ﷺ did that walking? Which means what? Hiking. We call it nowadays hiking. He went hiking the mountain of At-Ta'if to arrive at Thaqif. He didn't receive, of course, a better answer from them, and he goes down back to Mecca, walking. Can you do that? I'm sure if you try to climb a small hill over here, probably when you go, if you use the stairs, you're going to start panting, you know, when you arrive here. That was tough. And it's only one story or two. Most people, they find it more convenient to use the elevator than using the stairs. Walking was also the best sport they ever used. When the Prophet ﷺ was going in one of those military expeditions, they didn't have enough camels and animals to use for riding and sport and transportation. So they had to take turns. And for Tabuk, I mean for other actually one of those military expeditions, the Prophet ﷺ had 2 companions, Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Rawaha, and they used to take turns. Abdullah ibn Rawaha and Ali ibn Abi Talib, they felt shy that, you know, the Prophet ﷺ walks and one of them would be sitting on the camel. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, you know what, that's fine, you just, alhamdulillah, you keep up and we will keep walking. So the Prophet ﷺ insisted and he said, no way. قال لستما بأقدر مني على المشي. It doesn't mean that you walk better than me, or you're more capable to walk than me. Than I do. Said, and the same way, the Prophet ﷺ said, ولا أنا بأغنى منكما عن الأجر, and I still need the reward the way you want it. The Prophet ﷺ, when they were digging the trench, they had, you know, that obstacle, huge rock. Who finished the problem for them? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everybody, they all tried their best. They could not. At the end, they said, Ya Rasulullah, we need your help here. So he comes, just with three strikes. He just, actually that huge stone crumbled down to dust by the blessing of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sahaba and ulama. Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he became Khalifa, then he didn't like those people who fake piety and righteousness. You know, sometimes people when they act pious and righteous, what do? Remember when we talk about salah, when you show humility, how do they walk? They look down, they always look sad and so on, as if that's how you should be a religious person, that you're always sad and you're always upset. I mean, Umar bin Khattab, he saw one of those guys walking like this and he said, what's wrong with you? Are you sick? He said, no. So he grabbed his staff and he said, okay, then walk straight, otherwise I'm going to beat you with this. قال لا تمت علينا ديننا. Don't kill our religion for us. This is not the way a true believer walks. And remember when I said the Prophet ﷺ, how he used to walk, how they described his walking, They say the Prophet ﷺ's way of walking as if he's going down the hill. When you go down the hill, how do you walk? How your back would look like? Like this?
Straight.
No, it would be straight. Because you want to avoid, you know, flipping over or going backwards. So he would walk like this, means his back is straight. And he walks fully straight, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdurrahman al-Dakhil, one of those umara, the princes of Banu Umayyah, when they lost sovereignty on the east in Damascus and Sham for the Abbasids, he went all the way to North Africa. The Abbasids kept chasing him, and he kept going on all the way until he arrived at Morocco. And then what did he do? Now they're making a big deal out of it. He swam from the African shore to Spain right now. Anybody did that before? Allahu A'lam. Nowadays, they make competitions. And whoever does that, they will just, you know, they bring him on TV, they give them gifts and prizes and all this stuff and so on. Take names and... Abdurrahman al-Dakhil, he did that. He just went across the sea, swimming by himself. Shaykh al-Isnabi bin Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, preparing to meet the Mongols and the Tatar, he also was practicing kind of, I would say, in workout. And his workout was climbing the mountain of Qasyun in Syria, in Dimashq. So he was doing that, going up and down every day. So he would train himself, and he would work out before meeting the enemy. Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his book Zad al-Ma'ad, spoke about sport also and fitness. And he said that the main principle, the major principle of fitness is what? Motion, which means to move. So you have to move around, move your arms, move your legs, move your body, so that you get fit. Our worship, our ibadah, has also the concept of fitness and sport. Some of the ulama, contemporary doctors even, they speak about the physical aspects of our salah, saying that this aspect of the salah, standing for some time and then going down for ruku', means moving your back and going for sujood, moving your legs and feet and so on, they say it's one of those very simple exercise that fits all ages and everybody, men, women, young, old, and so on. It's easy for everybody to do, so that you can practice something at the beginning of your day or even along the day. Same thing with al-hajj. How many of you tried al-hajj? Have you gone to al-hajj? I mean, you know, if you've gone for hajj, you have to be fit in order to perform everything properly. I know we're running out of time, actually, because we started kind of late. The Prophet ﷺ and sports. What kind of sports did the Prophet ﷺ encourage and practiced himself? Can we guess? Wrestling. What else? Swimming. Probably he didn't do that when he was adult, but when he was young, he said that he learned swimming when he was in Medina. What else? Archery.
Horseback
riding. Let's see what the Prophet ﷺ, what the Prophet ﷺ do. First of all, running. That's what you said. Running. That's true. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she gave us that beautiful narration, which gives an implication that sports also, not obligation, but it's even recommended for women. If, of course, we do that the proper way, and we do it according to the codes of modesty. How do we know that? The Prophet ﷺ, he was traveling with the companions. The whole army was with him, ﷺ. And now imagine, and that's part of the fiqh of love, you're going to learn that, inshallah ta'ala, if you take the class, that you see, the Prophet ﷺ, I don't want to say didn't care about the whole army. It's just that he took some time while they were traveling. And you know what's the meaning of traveling? You ride actually on the back of a camel or a horse, and it's very tiring, very, very tiring. However, in order, of course, just to bring some kind of joy to the heart of his wife during those difficult moments of traveling, he would leave the whole army. And he goes to his wife, Aisha, and said, okay, let's race. To play with her, basically. He said, let's race. And he asked the whole army, just go forward. Just keep going on. Why? To preserve the modesty. This is now the code of modesty when it comes to practice, fitness, and sports, and so on for women. So he sends the army in front of them, and then he asks her, let's go.
Let's race.
So they stopped racing and running. She won the race. She was younger, and she was lighter, so she, when she ran with the Prophet ﷺ, she won the race. Was that offensive to him ﷺ? No. I mean, I'm sure if you try something with some of the people, if they try something with their wives at home, again, this is part of the fiqh of law, and they get defeated, that their wives, they won that whatever competition they have, they get offended. You know what? I'm going to show you. How dare you? The Prophet ﷺ didn't do that. He took that so friendly, you know, just like, you know, that spirit. And he waited for another opportunity. Another time, when they were also traveling, and he remembered that. So he said, okay, he asked the army to go forward. So they all went forward. And then he goes back. So Aisha said, okay, let's race again. So they go on the race. Aisha, she said, at the time, she got older a little bit, and she carried some weight. So the Prophet ﷺ, he won that time. And he said, هذه بتلك, one by one. Which means what? We're going to wait for a third time. Allahu A'lam, it didn't happen because we don't have any narrations for a third time. Just to break that tie. Now, the Prophet ﷺ also encouraged racing and running for the children. His grandchildren, they narrated to us that the Prophet ﷺ, he used to bring the kids of their family, of course, like Al-Hassan, Hussein, the children of Ja'far, his cousin, and so on. They all actually, they gathered, and then the Prophet ﷺ said, okay, anyone who, of course, he would start racing them, and he would ask them, whoever actually wins the race, he'll get so and so from me. So they all run towards the Prophet ﷺ, and the one who comes first, actually they all will come to the Prophet ﷺ, and so he would hug them ﷺ, and play with them. Also from the sports that the Prophet ﷺ practiced, horseback riding, even the Prophet ﷺ at one time, it's amazing to ride horses. I don't know if you do that over here, but it is amazing. Really, it is amazing, honestly. Subhanallah. You feel proud when you ride on the back of a horse and you know the horse. Yeah, start jumping. You enjoy it. And you would love that. I've done that myself. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. But the thing amazing about Rasulullah is that one time there was a kind of loud noise in Medina at night. The people got scared. They didn't know what was going on. So they all, by the time they put their saddles on the horses and they start, you know, going after that voice and that sound, they saw the Prophet ﷺ coming back from there with his horse, on the back of his horse, without even a saddle on. He was just grabbing actually the neck of his horse and he was running, going to see what's going on, and he came back and his sword was around his neck. So it's not like, you know, fixing his garment first and doing all the stuff and then just put the saddle on and then run with the horse. No, he went immediately and he came back. So he himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was a great knight himself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also encouraged people to do that. In Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to race horses and ask them to classify even horses according to their breed and quality. So those of good qualities, they would race against each other. And those of less quality, they would race, of course, for a less and a shorter distance. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged archery. And we have so many hadith discussing this issue. Swimming, combat fight, which is blade fencing with the swords, as we hear from Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was watching the Abyssinians in the masjid playing with their spears and their swords, and also wrestling. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was so strong that he actually embarrassed one of those people who thought that he was number one in wrestling in Arabia, but he lost it. Finally, inshallah ta'ala, I would like to give you a reminder about some of the, probably, I would say, instructions that when you do that, inshallah, when you practice, when you go to gym or even to practice, you know, your own schedule of sport and workout, you need to understand, realize, number one, that your workout should not take the whole time. It means that you don't spend the whole day there in the gym. I mean, if you work out, you just do that because you have a good intention for that. To have, inshallah, a fit body so that you could do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires from you. So it should not take the time of salah, should not take the time of ibadah, or it should not take the time of your siyam, if you're fasting Ramadan and so on. Number two, you don't practice anything that might cause harm to other people. Like, for example, boxing. I know that some people, they like boxing because they like to see, you know, the blood. But in Islam, if this is going to hurt the other people, you're not allowed to do that, punching faces. But you can still practice boxing, you know, with sand cases and something like that. But to do it with other people, you cannot do that. Also, sports, like which is, of course, this evening is going to be a decisive evening for so many people because of the Sambo. They would go there, and of course, instead of bringing alcohol, they might bring soft drinks and popcorn, watch, and start fighting. And they create parties. So this kind of partisanship, because of these aspects, are not allowed in Islam. Mixing is also one of those issues that we need to avoid. And for ladies, actually, they have an advantage on this issue. They can find solely female fitness or gyms, but for guys, it's very hard and difficult to find a gym that was made only for men. So they have advantage on this issue. But for the brothers, it's going to be very difficult for them to do so. Otherwise, they're going to have to find a time, a special time, that they can go and avoid really being there when they have probably ladies in gym. The reason I'm saying that is because we know how people dress when they go to the gym. So in order to avoid, of course, watching what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has haram for you, you need to avoid that. You need, of course, inshallah, to establish your own program. I cannot give you actually any special program for that, other than do your best, and the best time for you is the more convenient time for you, and the best time, of course, is always early in the morning. Wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Allahu Akbar.
Yeah, we have, inshallah, a few questions within about probably five. We can take, inshallah, 6 minutes. Yeah,
go ahead.
Yes.
I wanted to know, this might be off the topic, but I'm not sure. Meat along with fitness, what can
Sheikh Muhammad al-Sharif, he gave a lecture on the eating habits of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you probably, do we have it on there? Or?
We don't. Imam Rush? No, we don't have it, but they can download it from
Imam Rush.
Light upon light.
Okay, if you can download that, you'll find a short answer for it. Brothers, yes. What is the website? Sorry,
Light upon light.
Okay, but sisters asking about it.
It's lightuponlight.com.
No.
Or NadeemDownload.com.
Okay, hold on.
What is the proper attention that we should have when we go?
The what?
Appropriate attention.
Intention. Well, you know, many habits can become acts of worship if you accompany this with good intention. And the best intention when you do that is that you attain power, physical strength, so that can be help inshallah ta'ala become a better person, a better Muslim. In your ibadah, in your dealing with others, with your parents, doing your job, and so on. So always have that good intention, and of course, above all, that you please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that. Preserve this body, which is an amana, trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your hand, and then of course, using this body to do the acts of worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding you to do. Wallahu a'lam. That would be the best intention. Sisters, brothers, yes.
When you walk, are you supposed to have your head forward or your gaze down?
When you walk, do you have to keep looking forward or down? It depends on where you're walking. I mean, if you're walking when you have, you know, a lot of haram scenes and so on, of course you need to avoid as much as possible, but you don't just keep looking down, no. Just look straight and be aware of the surroundings. Wallahu a'lam. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.